CP family. Chad here with Tim. Tiebreaker series 59. This is the last tiebreaker of 2018. It's been a great year. This is gonna be a special tiebreaker. Tiebreaker 59. You're 59 years old, born in 1959.
Oh, that's huge.
It's all coming together today. yeah, it's been a great year, awesome year. A lot of this is a good time to kind of reflect on the past year, and we'll get into a little bit about what you should be reflecting on a little bit later. We're going to start off with the first question of the day, and that is on rest. This question is, how much rest should a junior athlete get? And it's like a twofold question, rest from tournaments and also rest from training. So why don't you kind of hit up on that and just the importance of rest in general?
Yeah, well, rest and recovery, that's R&R, you know, that's huge, you know. And, you know, there's a saying that says that you're going to pay big now, or you're going to pay, or pay a little bit now, or you're going to pay big later, you know. And that's sort of the way it is with rest. If you're either you're going to do a little bit of resting periodically and proactively now, or you're going to have to rest a lot more later, usually when you have an injury or some kind of a, you know, something that's going on with your body, you know. So rest is so, so important. And one of the things that I was fortunate is growing up in the Midwest is that I had seasons. And so, you know, we had, you know, winter, then we come into spring, go into summer, and then we go into fall. So one of the things that I would used to do is I would go ahead and make sure that there was a you know, extended period of rest as we finished up a season, so towards the end of a season. So like towards the end of winter, for example, which is coming right in before spring. Then you go right after the end of spring, and you, so you can hit that summer season hard. And then you get towards the end of the summer season and you still want to now hit that fall season hard. You know, that's kind of how we did that. And I thought that was really, really effective.
Yeah, I know. It's like tennis is kind of interesting compared to other sports where there's not really like an off season. So like a lot of these players are playing tennis year round, like kind of nonstop. How much rest should these athletes be getting?
Well, are you referring to now sleep, for example, too? Or is that something?
Let's talk about like how many, like, is it beneficial to take time off tournaments? Is it beneficial to take a week or two or three or four or five or 6 weeks off of playing tennis in general? Like, or should these athletes be playing 51 weeks a year? Like, how much rest should tennis players be getting?
Yeah, well, kind of unfortunately in the development process, like the way kids are developed now in the juniors is that they're playing the sport all year long and they're playing only one sport. And so that's kind of like two strikes against you, okay? And so if you don't get the rest, and if you don't maybe even do some cross training, which I know is another subject, you're gonna pay the price for that, you know? And we want you to be more proactive. And that's what we're gonna talk about, is it's really important to have rest. It's how much rest? It's kind of going to depend if, you know, what their ages are. You know, if they're right into those teenage years and right into puberty, they're going to need more rest because that's when the body is really starting to do massive growing. You know, when they're getting ready to do that growth spurt, they're going to need a lot more rest because you want them to have the full extent of all the growth that they're going to get. And if they don't have the rest, they're not going to get that full growth, you know, if they're really pushing it. And usually examples are like gymnasts, where they really go hard at young ages and it really affects the growth, you know, and that's sort of a proven, you know, that's pretty proven, you know. And you don't want to be messing around with the body. You want the body to just really be able to develop organically or naturally, and rest is what's going to really make that happen. So as far as not playing tournaments or resting from tournaments, that's actually more of a developmental question than it is of having a rest from tournaments. I would say on tournaments, it's just more, are they ready for their tournaments? Is it part of the goals that you've established? Is it a priority? And what exactly are you trying to accomplish in those tournaments? That's more for those questions. But as far as taking time away from tournaments, absolutely. And a lot of that is because you want them developed. You know, there's something that you're working on. We'll get into that a little bit later on the goals and things like that, and development priorities. But as far as rest, after every tournament, I always did rest. You know, Bethany always rested after every tournament. Bethany always rested extendably, like I said, seasonally. And sometimes she had a rest because she was sick.
Yeah.
And that's when I really kind of learned, and maybe that's what's happening with your kids, is sometimes they get sick at certain times of the year, almost like a habit, you know. And for Bethany, it was sort of early in the January time or February time, which is really crazy. And that usually meant we just were pushing it too long, that immune system was down, and we weren't resting enough for her.
Right. So are there any like general rules of thumbs that you would kind of recommend as far as how much time off to take per week, per month, and like a year in general? Like,
yeah, you know, just following that, say, a rule of 80-20. And so just say, for example, you play for 8 weeks, okay, and then you're going to rest for 2 weeks. It's really that simple, you know, that's just a general rule. But one of the things I want to encourage parents is, in the development of your kids, you want to find out, this is something that's a challenge, but you want to find out what, I mean, you don't want to overtrain, and you don't want to undertrain. So you want to train just the right amount. And sometimes in order to do that, you have to test it. And so maybe you pull them out for a week, maybe you pull them out for 2 weeks, have them maybe just do mental training on the side, maybe a little physical training, but pull them off the court for a week solid or 2 weeks solid, and let's see once if they come back strong as ever. And because every player is a little different on that, but the way the system works right now, it's like you can never get off that treadmill. You always have to be on the court. You always have to be in the gym. You always have to be doing those tournaments. You always have to be hitting those balls. And that's what's causing a lot of problems.
Yeah, I mean, burnout, it seems like nagging injuries is a little bit more of an issue. And I think a lot of that has to do, with just go, go, go. You know, everyone's trying to get better, but a lot of times you get better through rest. On a macro level and a micro level, you know, I've done a lot of research on sleeping, like in particular, and you know, that's obviously way more micro than this, but like getting your 8 hours of sleep is like one of the most ultimate performance enhancement things you could possibly do. Mm-hmm. Like you're that much more cognitively stronger, you're that much more physically able to accomplish a lot more when you're getting those sleeps. And there's been plenty and plenty of studies on how degrading it is if you're only getting 5-6 hours of sleep continuously. It only takes a week or so of getting 5-6 hours of sleep, and you're severely degraded, especially if you're a serious athlete training. So I was just listening to a Tim Ferriss podcast with LeBron James on it, and he tries to get 9 hours of sleep. If he can, he gets 10. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
he tries to take 2-hour naps. Like that guy is just a rest machine, and his recovery protocols are right there. And you know, the higher the level you go, the more it's going to be the emphasis on recovery. Even to this day and age, with Beth and like everyone on the tour, it's all about recovering after that match, mm-hmm. after that tournament, mm-hmm. so they can compete again. Who can recover the best? Mm-hmm. Everyone's playing at a high level. Like who can recover the best?
It's pretty interesting. That is very interesting. And when you talk about a minimum of 8 hours. I would say again, when they're in those growth spurt years, those teenage years, I would even go higher than 8 hours.
Absolutely, yeah, 10.
Moms and dads, let them sleep in. I mean, they really, you know, on some of those days they need to sleep in. But you know, when you talk about rest for the kids, I'm gonna talk a little bit about rest for the parents, because, you know, as parents, we really have a big grind. We have a big responsibility raising our kids, making sure they're at all their functions. We have jobs. You know, there's a lot of things going on, and that takes a toll on our immune system, takes a toll on our psyche, it takes a toll on our mental state, our spiritual state, our physical state, and we need to watch out, especially if we're in this marathon with our kids. You know, we want to take care of ourselves too. And so I remember a lot of times we were just flat out, Heidi and I were just flat out tired, and we said, we're not going to a tournament because we're tired and we're not going. You know, and we're going to rest. And you know, we did that. Another thing we did is once a year, remember how, I don't know if you remember, but we would take vacations and we would like get a cottage maybe or get on a lake, and we would spend a whole week. And obviously there's no tennis, no nothing. We're just having a great time as a family. We're having a great time, you know, doing activities like swimming and boating and things like that. And we made sure and did that as well, is, you know, to have some fun together as a family and that kind of thing. So that's also part of recovery as well.
Yeah, it's super important. And a good thing to do on this downtime, especially towards the end of the year, like we're getting into now with the holidays. Sometimes what people have off of school and off of work, but it seems like it's a really busy time. Mm. So people aren't getting adequate rest. But in addition to rest, it's also a good time to kind of, on these downtimes, to really reflect, especially in this, like right around the holiday time, to reflect on this past year. Just kind of see what you did, see what you accomplished, see the successes, see kind of the path you're on, and get ready for that next year. What's kind of the stuff that you would be thinking about, you know, on this downtime as far as reflection?
You know, the crazy thing is once in a while, Heidi and I would be thinking about not doing tennis anymore around this time because it was such a hard year, you know, as far as all the different activities we had, we were tired, you know, and that's why rest is so important. But yeah, you want to really reflect. And we took a lot of time every year. We would actually do that. And I still do that to this day as I reflect on this past year. But I've learned to focus more on the successes. I learned to focus more on the accomplishments, the improvements, you know, what are some things that my kids really improved in that I, especially in the personal growth, you know, what are some areas that I'm really proud of them? And I really want to let them know that, but I need to reflect on that. Otherwise we can really, it's a grind to also go into this next year when we're going, geez, we just had such a lousy, you know, this last year was so lousy. This last year was so tough. And it seems like everything went wrong and that kind of stuff, but really everything didn't go wrong. You know, and just the fact that you're breathing right now and you're watching, you know, this tiebreaker, you know, a lot to be grateful for.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's a good way to just cage the thoughts and go into the next year with a lot of momentum. It's also a good time to maybe set priorities for next year.
Absolutely. Yeah. And that's another thing. And that's what I do on a daily basis when I work with families personally, is that we set monthly development priorities. And the crazy thing is a lot of these priorities might stay the same for 4, 5, 6 months. And I can talk a little bit about, you know, what areas you want to kind of prioritize. But it's very, very important to set some goals going forward. As you're doing in this reflection time, you want to go into the future just a little bit. And you want to just say, what is it that we really would like to accomplish in this next year, in 2019? And you lay out maybe 5 priorities. And those priorities, for example, might be in certain areas. You know, one of the traps that we get into is we kind of are too general on things. You know, we're too general. So for example, if a goal is I want my kid to have better ground strokes or more solid ground strokes or more consistent ground strokes, you know, what does that really mean? You know, it's not something that you can actually track.
It's not measurable.
Yeah.
Measurable. You know, you want to be able to track it. You want to be able to measure it so you can see where you're at.
Yeah, and it's hard to stay on course that way. And so what I do with, you know, the families that we work with personally here at CP is that we would probably identify, say, 5 priorities, and those priorities might be in some different categories. Like there might be technical priorities, there could be physical priorities, you know, there could be mental priorities and those kind of things. And it's really important to then break that down even further. So for example, if it's a technical priority, it may be something really technical or technical, say on the forehand and backhand, and it might be something just as simple as transferring that weight to their back foot and bending your knees and doing that more consistent. And that actually gets into a physical goal, you know, to make that happen as well. But just by identifying it a little bit further and breaking it down just a little deeper, it's just easier to get the brain wrapped around it, and it's easier to communicate, not only just with the player, with your son or daughter, but also with the coach. It's easier to communicate. And then once it's communicatable, then now it's executable, and then it's accountable. And that's kind of what you want to happen.
Absolutely. And we'll definitely get into more goal setting in January, because that's when everyone, you know, nationwide is really setting the goals. But it's really, really important. And one thing I kind of wanted to offer to our CP Elite members, so if you're on the Tennis Blueprint and you want to get on the phone with Tim over the next week or so to talk about priorities, we're going to open that up to the first 5 people that kind of want that service. Tim's going to hop on the phone and you can talk to him about setting priorities going into the next year. So if you're interested in that, again, you have to be on the Blueprint to be eligible for this. If you're interested in that, send us an email at info@cpbymatic.com, info@cpbymatic.com, and I'll get you a scheduled call with Tim, and he can go over all the priorities and maybe what you should be looking at in your priorities, how you should be setting them, so you can go into 2019 with a lot of momentum. Mm-hmm. Do you have anything else to add?
Yeah, no, I think that's really awesome. And what I would just say is that in tennis, when you're trying to, you know, for us parents, we want our kids to always be improving. But a lot of times in this tennis process, we're always or mostly reactive. But what you want to do is be proactive. And I find that when I'm working with, say, families and players, and we're really proactive, and the more proactive we are, the more enjoyable this journey is, and the better results we get.
Absolutely. We'll end it on that. Hope you guys enjoyed it. It's been a great year. We'll see you in 2019. Everyone have an amazing holiday.
Yeah.
Happy New Year. Love you guys. We'll see you soon.
See you later. Love you guys.